I was telling Bill Davis what you were doing, and he said, "Oh, that's a marvelous idea. You know, families ought to do this." And
oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
I plan to get my dad, you know, the same way, and just have him talk, and it's great. Because this way you can look back, your grandchildren can look back.
That's
you can
right.
See what the person looked
that's
like.
That's right.
You hear him talking. And
I don't is that know. Writing all right, or do this you need another one? Okay, good.
You want to start now. You want to give your full name and date of birth.
Okay, I was born in 1923 on the 24th of April, and my maiden name was Margaret Work, but I was married to Dick Dilley, and so my name's now Peggy Dilley for most people.
Okay, can you tell us about when you first came to Sylvan Beach? White Lake, what brought you here, where your family was already here, I gather. You started mm-hmm. to come up in the summer. What was your first memory? What do you remember in your childhood about Sylvan Beach?
Well, I was so young the first time I came up, my memory wasn't working yet, I guess. But as I later on, as I came up, it was something you just looked forward to when you knew you were getting in the car and going to Sylvan Beach. So that was a big part of the whole year.
Where'd you live at the time that you drove up here with your family?
I lived in Elkhart, Indiana, which is just below the Michigan state line down there. Yeah.
And you were a work, correct?
I was a work.
Mm-hmm. How did your family get here originally? Did your father buy a cottage, your grandfather, your cousins? How did the family first come here and when?
Well, I don't remember what got Granddad here, and I wish I could, but that'd be Granddad Middleton, John Middleton. And they rented the cottage down here that Hunklers now own in 1898, and they rented that for 2 years, and then they rented this cottage and then bought it 2 years after. But no, I think it was about 1902 that Granddad bought this cottage, and now my taxes cost more than he paid for it, I think.
Oh,
but
God.
Yeah, that's true.
Well, do you remember approximately what the cost was in it?
No, I don't really, but a figure sort of like $2,500 sticks in my head.
That seems quite a lot, too, actually.
Well, for then,
yeah
but they lived down in St. Louis, so they would come up various ways, which is rather interesting. Sometimes, well, he was a railroad man. He was a traffic manager of a railroad. Well, the CCC in St. L., also at one time he was a traffic manager. Traffic manager. And then he was with the Frisco Railroad, but I don't know too much about that. But they would come by the railroad to Chicago and then take a Parmalee, which went between the stations, and Mother could remember the horses and the wagons going over the cobblestones in the streets of Chicago, which is kind of fun. And then sometimes they would take a boat from Chicago up to Muskegon, and then take another little boat from Muskegon up to White Lake. And this is, you know, this is before the Carolina and all this,
well, yeah,
all this business. Yeah, we're talking Mother was 10 years old.
President McKinley was president at that time.
Yeah, all that neat stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, what's a Parmalee? You said
the Parmalee was like a station wagon, I guess, that was horse drawn, though, that they loaded all their baggage and the people and everything on, and it took them. Essentially, it took them from station to station because Parmalee is French for between stations.
I'll be darned.
Yeah.
Oh, that's neat. And your mother does remember all that?
She did, yes. She'd be, she'd be 105, I guess, this year. But then sometimes they took the train all the way to Whitehall. But I don't think they did that very much. And then one of the little boats would bring them down the lake.
Down the lake, yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. Did you come up here every summer then of your life, just about?
I came up, maybe not for the whole summer. Sometimes it was just a little visit, and then in my teens, I'd be spending the whole summer. Betty Hartz, who's now Betty Allen, and I were talking about it the other night. They had the cottage next door, and we were reminiscing about some of the fun things we did then.
What were some of the fun things that you did then? When you were, about your teenage years then, or younger years? Or?
Yeah, I would say something, we were remembering how the walls hadn't gone all the way up to the ceiling in the cottage where they had rented those summers. They just went up part way, and we were laughing about her brother used to crawl along on the tops of the partitions. You know, there was, yeah.
Was there a separate?
Was a space between the top of the, they just hadn't run the walls all the way up.
Truly a summer cottage.
Truly a summer cottage, yeah. Right.
That's fascinating. What, when you were, let's say, 11 or 12 years old, were you allowed to go out at night up here? Did you go down to did you have beach parties? Did you date then? Or what was socially going on for you during your teenage years or your younger years here?
Well, Peg Van and I were talking today about the big part that the arcade played in your life. Nobody had a phone or anything, so you went down at least to get your mail. You had to go down to the arcade, and of course the tennis courts were right there. There was always a tennis game going on with the funny little square white thing in the middle of the courts that you'd sit in and then bang your heels against it, remember?
Yeah.
And make that marvelous sound. Well, we also used to sit on the great big safe in the post office waiting for what was her name? Rosie. Waiting for Rosie Spickelmeyer to get the mail put up, and we'd bang our heels against the safe until she'd holler out at us to stop that or she'd never get the mail put up. But you did. You went to the arcade, at least several times a day, because that's where you saw everybody. That was where everything went on. Meat and groceries were on the left-hand side, and the marvelous soda fountain, and all the candies, and the.
So the arcade was the center.
That was it. The people were playing cards out on the there was a porch outside. Well, the soda fountain was, when you walked in the door, the soda fountain was on the left, and when you walked behind that, there was a screen porch out there. And there was a cooler that was just a flat thing, and you just gave them a nickel for your soda, and then it was honor system, you just lifted the lid up, and there was ice and stuff in this thing, and then there was a little funnel in the floor so that as the ice melted, the water could go down through the floor, and they also dropped the tops off of the soda bottles in there.
Oh, wow.
I don't know why this came to mind, but
That's fascinating.
It was a fun thing, though. They had those licorice whips and the dum-dum bulldog things with the suckers in it, all the different flavors of suckers. They had a penny board that you could get a chance, and maybe you'd get a $5 bill for your penny that you put. Ask your daddy about that. He can tell you about that, I bet.
Well, go ahead and tell him.
The other thing they had was a slot machine in there.
I've heard about the slot machine.
You've heard about the slot machine. Well, one time, Betty's mother was down there, and she had a nickel left over from something that she'd bought. And she went by the slot machine, she just put the nickel in the slot machine, and with this, she proceeded to get the jackpot and had to take her hat off and hold it underneath the thing to get all of the from the jackpot. That was pretty funny.
Oh, that's wild.
You know, and another thing that would happen down there, Edna Bloomdahl's husband Leonard was next door in the grocery part, and somebody would catch a fish, and so they'd bring it in to the meat scale and have Leonard weigh this marvelous fish that someone had caught, and he'd get out a nice clean piece of brown wrapping paper and put it on the scales and put the, I'd seen that so many times, it was marvelous, and he'd very carefully weigh it. It was a big deal.
Did he clean it for the people?
No, I don't think so. I don't remember that part. I just remember this great, it was like a ritual of putting this,
the fish. Oh, that's exciting. Was Edna down there with
him? Edna was down there, and her mother and her sister, Helen, used to stay upstairs. There was an apartment upstairs. And then at one time, there was even a beauty parlor upstairs, and I can't remember the name of the... Holder. What was her first name, though? Peg Van can tell you this. Her first name was Holder, I guess, but I can't... Then her name was Dam. I think she was one of of that family, yeah. Okay. But that could have been a married name, of course.
Yeah. Now, on the other side, was that where, was Pitkins there at that time?
Yeah, that's right. That's right. That was it. And Edna and her sister were in there. And, you could get a beautiful Sunday for, a dime or something.
Good
something
try.
Terrible, probably 15 cents maybe, I don't know.
Probably a big one, too.
Yeah, and milkshakes, and it was marvelous.
When did the season begin up here at that time? Was it the 4th of July?
I think it still mostly began the 4th of July. Betty and I used to like to try to get up earlier because it was, you scout around and you got in on everything when it started happening and everything. Then, of course, you went to sailing school. And at that time, this is, 35? Okay. I think she went in 34 and I went in 35, and we could walk to the yacht club on the beach, by the beach.
I'll be doing that.
Well, it was a lot shorter.
Oh, it was a lot shorter?
Sure,
yeah,
sure.
Yeah.
And then sometimes we paddled her brother's canoe over, that little bitty canoe that Bill had.
But who was your sailing school teachers?
Bill Getz, yeah. I told Ben this year, my grandson, I told him that I wish that Bill Getz was still the teacher. Yeah, he did such a good job.
Oh, I imagine he did a phenomenal
job.
Yeah,
we had fun. Neil Manny was in there, pardon?
Did you have 3 years of sailing school?
No, there was only 1 year. Okay. It was only 1 year. And I still tie my clothesline with a bowline. Every once in a while, somebody will say, tie a bowline for me, I need one. I guess it's hard to teach someone else how to do it.
I remember it took me a long time to learn that.
I was Betty's crew on her, she had a cat boat, Bonus. Hers was called Bonus.
Was that a gap rig?
No, this was right, this was one of the first when the Marconis were coming in.
Were they faster boats than the gap rig?
They were supposed to have quite an advantage besides not being as cumbersome. You know, you didn't have that extra.
That big boom on it and everything.
Yeah.
And all the, I guess the rings they used to attach that on. With.
Yeah.
Huh. Who was the superintendent of the sailing school then? Who was in charge?
Dear, do you know? I don't know.
Was it Jack Guerin?
It could have been, but I really don't know. Neil could tell you. I'm sure Neil could tell you.
Okay. That's great.
But we used to do fun things like get a bunch of flashlights and sailboats and a crank up Victrola and some records and go for a moonlight sail.
Well, you're kidding. You put the
Victrola put the Victrola in the sailboat, and the wind had to be just right. We weren't gonna.
I would have been.
Yeah, you just sort of sailed around, listening to all those late 30s records and things like this with flashlights flashing on the sail, so nobody, everybody'd know you were there.
Yeah, but there'd be 78.
They were cat boats.
No, the records.
Oh yeah. Oh certainly. Oh certainly.
Okay.
Certainly. You had to crank up the little Victrola and put the little needle down on it.
Sure. It must have been neat to watch from the shore to hear the music off of a Victrola on a boat at night.
They didn't have very much fidelity, you know.
I can believe that.
Yeah, and I don't know that that people very far away could hear it. But that was fun. That's one of the things I remember. Another funny thing I remember is Jim Butterfield invited me to one of the Saturday night dances. And we used to alternate. One Saturday night you'd wear a formal, a long dress, and then the next Saturday night it was short dresses. Well, this happened to be a long dress night. And he came up and picked me up, and we walked out to the alley, and there wasn't any car out there, so I thought, well, you know, we walked down the hill, and I thought, well, somebody's going to come along, somebody's picking somebody else up, and they'll come along and pick us up, and not tall, we walked all the way down to the arcade and walked clear way out on the dock, and still hadn't said anything, got out, and his sailboat was sitting there, and he said, you're going to have to take your heels off. You can't get in my sailboat with heels on. And we sailed over to the yacht club to a dance.
Did your dress survive?
Oh, certainly. And I tease him about this every once in a while, but his brother had the car that night. It wasn't his turn to have a car, so his solution was to use the sailboat.
Who was his brother? Which brother?
It was Mac.
Mac, okay.
Yeah, it was Mac's boat that we used for, it was Budget that they used for teaching sailing too. I'm surprised it survived, but.
At that period of time, were you in the junior yacht club? Was there a junior yacht
There club? Was a junior yacht club, yep. We had a lot of fun. Yeah.
Do you remember about how many members on an average during your teenage years there were?
I think you'd have to ask Neil. He'd probably have a better memory about that than I did. What we did mostly was plan our own entertainment. We just decided we were going to have a beach party that night, and the whole mess of us would go around and raid ice boxes until we'd gotten enough weenies and marshmallows and things to have a beach party.
When you were doing this, I would say your age would be from 12 to 18 around in this time period.
Yeah.
Did you drink? The reason I'm asking that question, a couple of reasons, but first of all, Prohibition was on then, and I want to ask you down the line if you have any memory of Prohibition and anything. Prohibition was over though, wasn't it?
No,
it was over.
Yeah.
Did you all drink at your parties?
No. In fact, we didn't think that anybody we knew drank, I guess, at that time. But I've found out since that some of them had, but when we were out with them, they didn't.
So it's kind of a taboo thing
Yeah.
That's good, though. It's nice to have a childhood like that. That's good. The Great Depression was on at that time. Do you have any memories of that at all? The Depression years up here, was there anything you remember about that?
Not particularly, because at that age, it didn't really affect you too much. You didn't realize... you know, you came up here and everybody was in the same boat, sort of, and there wasn't this much fancy entertaining or fixing up cottages so they looked like something in, you know.
Regular home.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
They were all strictly, you just swept them out every once in a while, you know.
I kind of think there's a lot to that. I wish it were that way still.
And people still had maids. This is what I was trying to think. Had they had to give up much of anything? But there was a maid in every cottage, if not two or three or a couple or something. You know, Bert Hartz had a couple that she brought up every summer.
Were they black?
One couple was, but the other ones weren't. Well, one fun thing that they used to do too. There were quite a few black servants and things in the summer, and they'd all get together on Thursday night and go out together. So it was always fun to see them all dressed up in their fancy going to town dresses. They'd go into Muskegon and you know, after seeing them in their uniforms, you know, that was interesting. And they also used to hold church down in our boathouse. And I don't know, I think it was a Sunday nights that they would have their church sessions down right down in our boathouse.
I'll be darned.
Isn't that interesting?
That is fascinating. This was the maids that would
The maids and the whatever.
Yeah. Is that boathouse still there?
Oh, sure. Well, it's been rebuilt because it was falling apart. And it's the first one.
That's the very first
boathouse.
But the outside Middleton. Is still the same, basically.
Yeah, they just redid it. They just had it rebuilt.
Oh, that's fascinating. You said that your family was the work family. How many relatives do you have here now and married into the Sylvan Beach or whatever? You're a Middleton, too, aren't you? You're close to it?
Well, this is it. There weren't works up here because it was because of my mother that we came up here in the first place. Daddy's family had a cottage at Clinger Lake, but Mother's family, the Middletons, were basically the ones here. So I had a whole bunch of cousins that I grew up knowing. It's unusual for, of course, it happens here for a number of people, but it's unusual for people to know cousins very well. If you live in Elkhart and your cousins live in Kansas City, for instance, and we spent our summers together.
Got to know the family.
There are three cottages in a row that are all my family, cousins, and then the Jackman cottage is Lucy Lee's mother was a Middleton.
Oh, she was a grand.
Oh, I just loved her, yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. She was fun.
So you have three relatives that own cottages here right now, then?
Well, four.
Four, okay.
Four. Well, I mean, counting me, okay. There's this one, and then Megan has the next one, and then Dot Knock Brewer and Nancy Kingman and John Middleton have the yellow cottage, and then the Jackman cottage down there.
Okay. I've seen down in the lighthouse a display of Ed Middleton,
mm-hmm.
Do you remember him very well?
Oh,
can you tell us something
very
about
well.
Him? He seemed to be a pretty exciting fellow.
Well, he was just a nut on ships. And he was in the Navy. In fact, the picture of him down in the lighthouse is in his Navy uniform, I believe. Blanche, his wife, got that arranged because people kept asking, well, who's Edward Middleton,
Yeah.
But his father and my mother were brother and sister. And they grew up in St. Louis, but then when Grandma and Granddad were bringing their children up here, he would have been about 12 years old when he first came. When his father would have been 12 years old when he. See, shall I back up?
Go ahead, yes, please.
His father and my mother were brother and sister. So the two of them grew up in this cottage when his father, when Eddie's father was about 12 years, would have been about 12. So then this cottage outgrew the family, so then they tore down a cute little cottage that, I forget who it belonged to, that'd be in the book. And so then Eddie grew up over there in that cottage. They used to rent some summers, but then they built the big yellow one. But I knew him very well. Very fond of him, very fond of his wife. They both died of cancer.
Yeah, he seems to be quite a dynamic man from all I've heard and read.
Well, he was a great sailor. He had an E-boat. Gee, I can't think of the name of that either, right off. And didn't like the fact that he had to work to make a living, because that meant he could have only 2 weeks up here every summer. But then when he retired, they shared the cottage with Dot Knox, so when he retired, he spent about a month and a half up here then. But he got into taking slides of a lot of the ore boats and things of this sort. He's always been interested in that, and he has written up all he could find on boats of this area. And that's a very interesting book that he's gotten done. It's a loose leaf notebook.
Oh, why? Do you have one around anywhere? Is there anyone?
Well, I happen to be taking care of it because they're worried about somebody maybe taking pages out of it or something like that if they leave it in a cottage where somebody isn't there full time and everything. So I do happen to have it, but I'm responsible for it, so I'm...
Is there any possible way to copy it ever?
Possibly, yeah.
Does that sound like a good idea?
But I think you ought to talk to his children.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So in 1935, you were about, I can't remember your date of birth now, but you were a teenager.
12.
About a teenager. Mm-hmm. Did you keep coming to White Lake through those years of the Second World War past the Second World War?
Yeah.
Can you tell me basically how many straight years you had there from the 30s?
Well, it wasn't just every single summer and all summer because my aunt was in this cottage too, and Lucy Lee and Billy Mack, so there wasn't room for both my mother's mother and her family and my aunt and her family. So sometimes we'd be up maybe a couple of weeks, or maybe I'd be up all summer with because my grandparents were here too. And so sometimes I'd be up here with just them, without mother and dad. And I learned a lot from my aunt. It was a very enjoyable stay when I was here.
That's fascinating. So you were here during the war years too?
Some. Not a whole lot. Because it wasn't until, I can't remember when they had the silent auction for the property from the hotel. And that's when my Auntie V then built her cottage. That's the Jackman cottage now. And so then I was up here more
space.
More space, and then I was bringing my children up.
Can you explain to me, you used the term the silent auction? Can you explain?
Well, I figured it was sort of a silent auction because when the hotel was taken down, I guess because it was probably a fire hazard and wasn't going to be able to stand the fire laws, the
code.
Yeah, it would be quite a task. They tore it down, and also along with the hotel was the annex, which is where the Holloways, were in there. But beside that double cottage, well, at that time it was a double cottage, there were two. Before the Holloways got it, there were two properties, and in order to, you bid in on it, and you just put your bid in an envelope, and I don't remember whether she said which one of the two properties she wanted, but Ann Field got the one where the stones are now, and then Annie V got the property where the Jackman cottage is.
Okay. And that was that's the Sylvan Beach there, was the Sylvan Beach Hotel that was there, and that was just torn down.
That's right.
Burned down or
anything
like that.
But I wasn't here then. I think I'm glad I wasn't here to see that torn down, or the arcade, I think that would have been, and to see the dock go. That dock was a marvelous.
What year did this happen?
I don't know. Somebody can tell you, and I think it's even in the book.
Okay.
I think it's in the little blue book.
Okay.
Okay.
All of these teenage years of yours, can you, I imagine you dated in that, can you give me just a general idea of the names that were in your age group, or guys you dated, or something you can remember that would give the people that were about your age that were in your group, can you recall their names?
Maybe? Yeah. Well, of course, there was Betty and Neil Manny and Jim Butterfield and Jack Dennison and the Dakes and Sis Getz and Barbara. And let me think. There were some people named Halstead who rented the cottage that the Summers own. They were in there one year. And the Taggarts. Oh dear. That sort of covers
the nucleus of
the... Yeah, and the neat thing was that we didn't, excepting for maybe one or two of them, we didn't get serious or anything. We'd just go as a group and do things. You weren't coupled off. Everybody had somebody at home that they were
seeing
and everything, or maybe kind of not going steady, but, you know.
Yeah. To a certain extent.
So it was just a whole group of us having a neat time all the time. Just
what were the things you did with the whole group? Did you drive anywhere? Did somebody in the group drive? Did they have a car?
When they got old enough. Of course, yeah. Jack Dennison was one of the first ones to be able to drive. I remember going down to a race down at Spring Lake, a regatta that was held down at Spring Lake, and that was a lot of fun. But that was a big deal to have somebody about your age driving a car all the way down to Spring Lake with kids in it.
You know? Do you remember what type of car it was? They had a
Packard, I think it was. I think it was a Packard. Beautiful car. It was a gorgeous car.
Very heavy and strong too.
Oh, no, definitely, and big.
What'd you do with the regatta? Did you just stay there for the day and then drive?
Yeah, we did then, more or less. Yeah, I think later on, and this was the summers that I wasn't coming up, that Betty would tell about staying at some little motels that were down there when they had a regatta down there. But I don't know about that.
Wow. So some of the later on it turned into a real adventure and kind of staying the night and everything.
All that stuff, yeah.
Was there, just for a social context, I think, was there drinking going on then at the regattas and everything?
Not as far as we were concerned.
Right.
No.
Right. You mentioned before, you just kind of hit on it, and while we're on there were a lot less of the social things going on back then. I mean, cocktail parties each night now almost up here. Was that going on in the 30s?
No, 40s? No, not at all. And people just bring one or two dresses or suits up for anything that they might happen to need it for, or going to church or something. But as far as having to dress up a lot to go to parties, there just wasn't that much. Even when I was a teeny bopper, the older, you know, like my aunt and uncle, it just wasn't that much. Yeah.
And they were probably trying to get away from that type of life.
That might well be. They came up here to enjoy this place.
Yeah. Right, and just to be themselves. Yeah. And
not do what they were doing at home all the time.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you remember by any chance maybe what year that kind of started to happen, that everything became more formalized and socialized?
Not really. Or whether it was people from a certain place that came here that needed that, or what accounted for it, I don't know.
Yeah.
But it's interesting. Of course, the parties are a whole lot of fun, but it's a different sort of
atmosphere.
Yeah. One thing they used to have down, this reminds me.
Great.
One of the things they used to have down in the old Wob Club, and this would be when I was like 10 years old or something, they'd have barn dances and this sort of thing. And Mr. Vadaveter was, this is old Mr. Vadaveter, Bill's father, would help the young ones of us learn how to do the shottish or some of these things. And they, you hear, you were 10 years old with these other people, and they're just as cute as they can be, showing us how to do these funny dances that they knew how to do.
That's beautiful.
Yeah, it is. It really is. Yeah, and square dancing. I can remember Bill Allen, who was the policeman. He played a violin, played a fiddle, really, the way he played it. And you see, he played for the barn dances over at Schiller's. And that was always kind of fun because apparently his hair was getting gray and this bothered him, so he used shoe blackening, and he'd cover up his hair with shoe blackening. Well, he'd get fiddling so hard and he'd get so hot that the black would start slopping on down onto his white collar down here. So we have fun watching to see how long it was going to be before the shoe blackening came down here.
Oh, that is fun.
But he had been a Chicago policeman, and he kept his uniform. He drove a Model T Ford, and he was, I think, mostly Indian, if not not completely Indian. But he was the policeman down by the arcade, and every time a car came by, if somebody wanted to walk across, he'd stop the car, and you got to walk across. And he was really a whole part of the action. He was something else.
Just a character.
We had another one or two after that, Dexter, and I don't remember the other one's name, but they weren't nearly the characters that Bill Allen was.
Where did he live?
He lived over on Michelinda, and I think it's probably about where the Mahoney property is over there, because as I remember, it was down low, and it was a sort of a glorified shack that he lived in anyway. And Eddie Middleton loved to tell the story about he went over there one time, and a great big log was run through the window and then on into his fireplace. And Eddie said, well, you know, why do you do? Well, he said, it takes a lot of energy to saw up wood. So you just kept pushing this thing, and it was so long that it was sticking out of the window. And he also had a funny little place sort of burrowed in the side of the sand dune over where Tommy Roberts' property is. Not where he lives, but the cottage down there.
Right, the old Norris place.
Yeah, well, right back of the, behind, but really behind Tommy's.
Okay, I heard that if somebody used to live up there, Indian, they called him. Yeah.
That was Bill Allen.
I'll be darned, I never knew that.
And he had, I guess, a little boat that he'd put out in the water and go fishing and things, but... I think Tommy could show you where his place was, because it was just virtually kind of dug into the sand dune.
Well, I've seen that up there, a little like foundation or a little thing up there that looked like it was an old, had been a house there one time.
Well, Tommy's dad made him move it over because it was right on the Roberts property, and so Tommy's daddy wasn't too happy about this, so I guess he had to move it over a little bit, but... Mm-hmm. He had it for quite a while.
So he'd just come down to Sylvan and work down?
He just stood down there and stopped the traffic. He's buried up in the cemetery by Duck Lake.
Oh, you're kidding.
No. I'll
be darned. There must have not been that much traffic. Was there that much traffic?
No, No, and we're talking about these old...
these old
things. So they weren't exactly racing along anyway.
Was the road paved?
In fact, Jack Hansen told me one time that the reason that Murray Road got paved at all was they had great ideas of putting a bridge across the channel and continuing on the other side, because you'll notice on the other side the pavement comes all the way down to the water. Yeah. So they ended up putting the little ferry that went across and held four cars. You remember people telling about that? Well, you couldn't possibly remember.
No.
But it held four 1920s type cars, and it was, I can't remember, it was run by a motor off of a car or a truck, and I can't remember whether it was a Chrysler or what it was, but the cable for it to go across on then had to drop down in the water so that somebody in a sailboat with a keel on it could go through without getting hung up on the cable. And sometimes if the wind was blowing real strong, either into White Lake or out of White Lake, then the ferry boat would kind of bow out depending on the wind. It's quite interesting.
Oh, that is.
But to go over to the Valley of the Pines, or the easiest way was to get on the ferry boat and go across.
Well, that's fun. I never heard that. And speaking of the Valley of the Pines, that brings me to a question that I always ask is, Mr. Sedoni, did you ever, do you have any stories about him? Did you meet him? Did you ever talk to him?
Yeah. He used to follow the races, the sailboat races, so when I would come up and I wasn't Betty's crew, then if there was enough room left on, because he used one of the life-saving boats to go around and follow the races. And he'd stand back there hanging on to the tiller, and he'd have his riding breeches and his high boots and everything. And
swagger stick too?
Well, I don't remember that. I don't remember that. But he was a very imposing figure standing up there, and then the boat loaded up with all the people. And so that was a lot of fun. So yes, I did know him. And one story that I heard was years later. I was living down in St. Petersburg, and I was sitting next to a girl at a meeting, and she asked me about doing something in the next couple of weeks or something, and I said, oh, I can't, I'm going up to Michigan. You know, the usual, where in Michigan? And we narrowed it down. We both had spent our youth at White Lake. And her father had owned Cherokee Lodge across the lake. And I said, oh, I know what you mean. It's the place where it's all, there's nothing around Cherokee Lodge, and the flag was always flying. Oh, yes, she said that flag had to go out up all the time. Well, somebody was visiting, and the girl was kind of in doubt whether she should marry this fellow or not. And so my friend Lois said, well, I know somebody that can help you. Now, we'll go down and see Professor Sedoni, and he can tell you, may give you a little insight into this. So the girl decided she'd just gotten her engagement ring, and she figured rather than to have him see anything that would show that she was engaged, she'd take this ring off. And so the two of them went down there and they walked in the door and sat down, introductions, and Professor Sedoni looked at her and said, well, why did you take off your engagement ring?
I heard he was
a really
wizard.
Really?
Sorts. Yeah. Did you ever go over there and talk to him in his house around the ground?
I used to go over with Auntie V sometimes, and it was fascinating. He had all these experiments and things to show, like, I can't remember how many billiard balls he had strung on strings. Did you ever see those?
Yeah, see, we dropped two.
Yeah, you dropped two out here and two more. And he had a number of things in this laboratory of that nature. And had a little chapel on the grounds. And, oh, it had a marvelous swing. A swing that was hung down from, I don't know how tall up, but it was just, you know, it took forever for the cat to die on it.
Oh, wow. So it was a pretty friendly place, and you go over there kind of.
It was delightful.
That's fascinating.
Yeah.
That's fascinating. I heard about his book, Gates of the Mind, I believe it's called. I want to try to find a copy.
It isn't in the library?
I haven't gotten to that stage.
I bet it is.
It's a good idea.
I bet it is. Yeah, I'd like to read that.
Yeah, I just like
uh-huh,
to
I would.
See what I'm dealing
and he
with.
Used to write articles in the Chicago Tribune. I don't know how often. I don't think it was every day, but there was an article in the Chicago Tribune.
What do you remember about the Carolina? Do you remember that coming in?
Mm-hmm.
Did all of Sylvan Beach come down to meet it, or what was the schedule? Did it just arrive on a Friday and leave on Sunday, or did it make different trips during the week? Or
I can't remember what time it arrived on Friday night. It's funny, because Peg Van and I were just talking about that today. She said it came in at 6 o'clock in the morning. Came in at, wait a minute. Yeah, it came in at 6 o'clock in the morning when it came in on Friday, and then it left on Sunday night. That's the way it went. On Saturday morning, wasn't it? Saturday morning it came in at 6, because they'd get on, well, Granddad lived in Chicago, Grandma and Granddad lived in Chicago then, and so he'd get on the boat after work and spend the night coming across, and then I guess it came in at 6 in the morning, and the captain would, in fact, Peggy was telling me the name of the captain. I hadn't remembered that, and I couldn't tell you now, but she can. Would toot the horn real loud, and Peggy said everybody get up and throw their clothes on and run down to greet everybody that came in. And that was quite a big deal, you know, and the smoke coming out of the smokestacks. But Sunday nights then, when the fellas would get back on the boat, you'd say goodbye to them down there, and then you'd have to run like the dickens to get up here because you wanted to flash a flashlight, and you did certain fancy things with your flashlight so Granddad would know that was you.
And then he'd
have a little stateroom with a porthole, so he'd put his skimmer, you know, his straw hat, over the porthole and do things back at you. That was fun.
Oh, that must have been.
Yeah, it was. It was fun.
And you're right. I guess they all did wear the boaters back.
Sure. Oh, and they were all dressed up. Yeah, and I suppose the next morning you went to work off the boat. I imagine. I'm guessing.
Some of them had cabins so they could get their rest.
Yeah,
if they wanted
right.
To.
Well, they slept all night. Yeah.
Was there a restaurant in there, anything like that?
There must have been, but I really don't know. I really don't know the answer to that.
What year did that stop running, the Carroll line up here?
I can't answer that either.
Was it prior to the Second World War?
Probably. Probably.
Prior, yeah. Something like that, yeah. That's fascinating.
It was fun. I can remember one time somebody had a car that they wanted to get from here to Chicago, and it seems to me it was a Model T, but it was about that vintage anyway. And they put two planks from the top of the steps at the arcade down onto the pier. And this character drove his car with a wheel on each one of these planks and then managed to get the thing on the boat the same way, and this was a little scary. They had a neat part that opened up where they put the baggage and, you know, all the stuff that they hauled, and this car went on into that. I don't know what they did over in Chicago, but that was pretty thrilling.
Yeah, but it was. so they bored down there, and then you run here to the bluff.
Yeah.
And then watch the boat go.
Yeah,
out.
That's right.
And it was just probably, they had a horn going the whole time and everything as it pulled out. And how fast would that go? Probably,
I don't know. I don't know that much about them. I don't know.
Incredible. How many feet long was it?
I don't know that either. I might be able to look up an Eddie's thing and it would probably have the dimensions.
Wow. That's a neat part. I wish I could have seen that. I think that's probably one of the most romantic things.
They also, the captain also used to blast the horn in some series, and then you could hear the echoes bouncing back and forth off of the hillsides on White Lake when he would come into White Lake. And it went all the way down to the end and turned around and came back.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So they had to go down there to find room or something?
Well, that's why, I think that's why it's called Goodridge Park. It was the Goodridge Lines, and wasn't a dock down there?
I don't know.
Boy, you're going to be busy just checking up on all these things.
All these things, I know. That's fascinating. Do you remember the biggest storm you ever remembered? Do you have any memories of any specific storms?
There was one. When I must have been about 13, 12 or 13, and it was during a Mackinac race, and about six of the boats came limping in here, and grateful that they could get in here, And then they found out that there weren't telephones handy and all this sort of things. And I guess the storm had also blown down some of the wires or something too. But that was quite thrilling because these fellas with their
beat up boats.
From the race. That was a pretty good storm.
Approximately what year was that?
Well, let's see. If I was about 12 or 13, that'd be 36.
I think Neil Manny told me about that same story.
Yeah, like he that. Probably has the date fixed pretty well.
37, someplace
around in there. Yeah.
Did you see the storm yourself? I mean, was it a
well? Yeah, because we went down to the arcade because this was where they were all coming in.
They just came down
up
there and buoyed out there.
And they were, I think they were quite in awe, shall we say, of this storm. But it was quite a storm.
Did it roll in like late at night or sunset?
No, I think it was in the evening. I think, as I recall, it was dark when we were down there.
So you felt like you saw it coming, and then all of a sudden people started to escape the lake. Was the lifeboat station functioning then?
No, I think that was long gone.
Gone by then.
Wow. The tracks were still there that they used to roll the boats down on. You know, they had like railroad tracks that they rolled the life-saving boats down on.
Yeah.
I have a picture in this. I'm not sure that it's in the two pages I have here, but there's a picture in Mother's photo album that's got to turn up for you of the life-saving fellows having one of their, there was a while they had to turn the boat over and right it again, and they had regular practice and
doing that.
Because what they had to do was row these boats out into Lake Michigan when they were needed.
Yeah, that must have been amazing to row out there and try to rescue somebody.
Yeah.
Golly,
But in the channel, this picture shows them in the channel with the boat turned over and they're working away.
Practicing. Their craft.
Right. Well, another thing, when Mother was a girl up here, the lighthouse keeper's wife would sew middies and trousers for the life-saving fellows across the channel. And so she made some midi shirts out of the same sort of canvas fabric for Mother and her sisters and any of the other girls around here. So a lot of the pictures of the girls then, they were wearing these, sailor tops, like regular sailor top. So then she also made skirts for them and so that they could go out and play. The only clothes that they had then for the most part were these long black skirts and the frilly little blouses and all these cute little things.
So this was what
amounted to play clothes for them then.
They were just canvas.
They were, well, whatever the fabric is that they make midi shirts out of.
Wow, well, that was a godsend for some.
Yeah, it was.
Do you remember the name of the lighthouse keeper?
Well, Robinson was one of them, and Bush was one, and I can't remember which one was there that his wife made these middies. But if we'd find the year that which one of them was there in like 1898, then we'd have or 1900 would be a little closer to it. Most of the pictures in her photo album are 1907. This is why I have to find it for you.
Yeah, well, we'll find it. That's great.
But she was all grown up by then.
So I guess I probably, you really grew to love this place as a child, the smells and just all the different natural things. Made it very special and mysterious, I'm sure, in many ways, for a child. Do you remember any ghost stories you heard around here? Any paranormal experiences around here in the cottages?
No, I don't think of any of those. One terrible thing that happened was down in the cottage that's the Woodward cottage that's books. The girl that they had working for them that summer had washed her hair and was drying it in front of the stove, and it caught fire. Have you heard this story?
I heard it years ago, but I haven't heard it.
And she was working, I believe, for a Guerin family that had rented the cottage. But she went running out, and of course that didn't help at all. And she died. She didn't make it. But I can't remember if somebody tried to roll her up in a rug, but they did try very hard. Whoever was handy was doing his best to but it was terrible.
Oh, and then, of course, the help wasn't very fast getting here at that time, probably. There weren't a lot of phones to hospitals or things.
There were no phones, even when I was growing up, excepting the Myers, which is the Hunkler cottage. The Myers, for some reason, had a telephone. He was a Baptist minister in Chicago.
Mr. Myers?
Mr. Myers. Not Bob Myers, but his father.
Okay.
Johnstone Myers. And so if you just had to make a phone call, you used the Myers. Or there was a phone in Western Union at the hotel. And Betty and I used to get tips if we delivered a telegram. If we had nothing else to do, we'd hang around the hotel. And if a Western Union message came in, why, we'd rush it to somebody's house and maybe get a nickel for delivering a...
There was a regular key thing there?
I don't know how they did it or whether it was up by telephone, probably. I'll bet it was by phone. Because they did have a phone there.
Okay.
Mrs. Myers ran the hotel.
When you were up here, how often did you go to town? Or did people gather together and say, I'm going to go to town today? Does anybody need anything?
Oh, that's what they mostly did.
So it'd just be kind of a general
go. That's right.
They'd
double up, or the maybe the family had only one car, so if the wife was left up here, she was dependent on Leonard and Edna for grocery delivery or getting whatever she needed down at the arcade and the grocery section. You didn't go to town very much. They weren't up here
to go to town or
hunt antiques or something. You know, they weren't looking for, it was all right here.
Did you go through periods when you were growing up here during the summer that the water would be way up and then down? Do you remember high points and low points, or was it a big deal then?
Well, we didn't think anything of it, because first you walked out about 15 or 20 feet farther than you can now to get to the bluff, and then you took all these steps down. I think it was something like about 90 steps down to that level. Then you went on a gangplank sort of an arrangement that was a long walk over to the next steps that took you from the sand dune down onto the beach.
So there was
and then you had to walk out to the water after that.
So all the way in the period that you were going up, there was a massive...
A whole bunch of sand out there.
Wow. Do you have any idea what happened? Why we're in the position we're in?
I have no idea, excepting I think the whole lake has a problem, but I think the problem right here in this area, a lot of it they blame on the solid pier. Rather than the pier that I have a picture of with the, you know, with all the wooden things, so that you had the lateral flow of water along the shore, okay, instead of having it come hitting a solid cement structure.
I hadn't thought of it.
Because they've had troubles all up and down Lake Michigan
with the solid cement
structures. just gradually, bit by bit, it's dug. So that we probably, along here and down, especially at Bowen's and along there, probably wouldn't have the real problems that we have if it weren't for that. But we would still have the problem that the whole lake has.
Right, with the whole lake's going through with this.
Yeah.
Who was the most famous person you ever met at Sylvan Beach? Can you think of any notables that you saw, not even met, but were here?
Gee, that's interesting. Well, how about Frank Adams?
There's a famous songwriter of the period and everything else, Frank Adams.
Frank Adams. He owned the house that Peg Van has. In fact, he stayed up here a couple of winters, I understand.
Was he a character too?
He was just a dear person. He was just a very fine man, very talented.
And did he play for the Jinxes then?
He used to write, he and my Auntie V would new words to songs and things. Well, it much as you do now, you know, the same sort of thing to adapt it for what was going on here. And they had some rather fancy things that they put on then under his direction.
That wasn't during your period.
He'd sort of given that up. But another thing with Professor Sidoni, when I was, say, around 10, 11 in the Jinx, he'd come over and put the makeup on us. He had all the pots of stuff and everything, and he'd do the makeup for the Jinx.
I'll be darned.
And Art Sidoni ran the funny little thing. In fact, they made it, I understand. Art told me one time that they made this... Well, you've seen it in years past. It had to burn up with the fire, but it had the different colored lights.
Yes, I remember.
And
that.
So the boys would be up there working the little spotlights.
And Art Sidoni made that.
I think they did. Yeah, he'd love to talk to you if you want to talk to Art.
I was sick.
I don't think he is. He sick?
I heard somebody told me. I asked somebody specifically.
Well, Joe died, but Art. I didn't know if there was anything matter with Art.
Really? But somebody said don't talk to him. You know, I don't know why. It was like that he wasn't all there or something helped.
Because he loves to talk about these things. Yeah.
Where does he live?
He lives over on the other side in what was Sidoni property that he built a house.
Okay, and he'd just be in the phone book. So.
Yeah.
Okay, great. Because I heard somebody said don't do it.
His wife's name is Bea. B-E-A.
Now, who was Auntie V?
Well, Auntie V was Lucy Lee's mother. Okay. That's Vera Downing.
Wow.
And she was younger than my mother by about 3 or 4 years. And so we shared the cottage with her family, too, you see, as well as having Grandma and Granddad in here.
That's wild.
But she was really quite an influence on my life. She showed me how to pick out melodies on the piano. We had an old piano, and she could play only in the key of C, and I think simply because she just never bothered to go beyond that. Yeah. But she was the one that got me started playing by ear.
I'll be darned. Well, you must have had a talent for that, though. I mean, obviously,
well,
you have a knack.
I guess it is, because I've had, my grandchildren, I thought, would be interested. My kids couldn't pick up on it. I don't have a grandchild that can pick out the things.
What age were you when she started?
Probably about 5 or 6.
6 or 7.
Yeah. That's 6, 7 maybe. I don't know. I don't remember. I just remember the old piano in that room.
Oh, that's neat. That's neat. In your teenage years, and when the Jinx, was it still going then? It wasn't still really, was it in the 30s? Was there good Jinxes or...
Men, yeah, they were, yeah, they were still Jinx, yeah.
They were back in the full swing.
Yeah.
And it was, because I knew there was a period where it dropped off. I got it on another tape. But
I didn't know that.
Yeah, there were several years, many years, as a matter of fact, where there was no Jinx, a period of time, that Barb Wagner put on Jinxes, like at the Naveen Porch or something like that, that there were no jinxes. But at the time that you were growing up, then there were jinxes there in the 30s. Do you remember any of the, who directed the jinxes? Do you remember somebody from your period that would direct it?
Isn't that funny? I'd have to think real hard about that. I remember one funny act that they did. They dressed up these great big boys in tutus, and they somehow or another had to fix. I don't think they wore wigs. They had big bows on their heads or something, and they were galumphing around on the stage. It was one of the funniest things I ever saw. One time they did an act of the Floradora Sextet with six couples. For instance, Lucy Lee and Billy Mack, but the girls all had great big huge hats on, and they were all dressed up like the gay 90s sort of thing, and that was really quite clever. That was quite an act that they did. That was a marvelous one, but I can't remember who did direct.
Were they the people who lived in the Wild Club at that time, maybe?
That might be. Well, I tell you who can probably fill you in on that is probably Monty Terryberry, because she was one of the ones that, was it Mr. Clay, I think, brought over from Grand Rapids, and she stayed in the rooms in the Wob Club and directed the activities.
I'll be darned.
And she was, you know, 20 maybe, but when she was maybe going to college or something, and was talented, and so she it could well be that she directed them, but I bet she could tell you.
That's a good idea. Did many of the kids have in the junior high club when you were growing up, did they have power boats? Do any kids have power boats?
Just the one in particular with a power boat was, you just mentioned the name of the, we were talking about the policeman.
Oh, Bill Allen, yeah.
Yeah, now the people, why can't I come up with that name of, Harvey Norris. And boy, we referred to his stink boat all the time, because he did nothing but just race around and around and around all the time in his little, but it was just a putt-putt, really. But a noisy putt-putt. Noisy putt-putt. But the rest, everybody else sailed.
And he drove the world nuts.
And he was kind of looked down on, you know, this business of just putting around. And I don't know that he even ever sailed. Isn't that funny? I don't remember his sailing at all.
And I guess the motor was an outboard type.
Yeah, oh, sure. Certainly. Oh, certainly. Yeah.
Those were kind of big and tall, long way, too, I think. Yeah. Really big, or long.
It was just a boat, just a regular boat.
Was the marina next to the yacht club at that time? Was there any sort of marina there?
I don't think so. In fact, I'm quite sure there wasn't, because I can remember sailing into the space where that dock is now. So in the 30s, I'm quite sure there wasn't a marina there, but of course I could be wrong.
I just wondered.
Maybe. Well, now wait a minute. Harry Pellinger must have started that.
I wonder what,
didn't he?
Yeah, I think he might have.
You're going to have to nail him. You're going to have to nail him when he gets here, because he can tell you all that stuff.
That's really about all I have right now. You can think of anything that you'd like to think of, add, or think about, or talk about, something special. Mm-hmm. I mean, just anything you can remember, because you're the one that knows. You're the source.
Well, I can't think of anything in particular right now. I might come up with something later on and fill you in on it or something.
Yeah, well,
it's fun to dredge these up.
Oh, it is.
Yeah. It is.
Because there's just every one little clue.
Yeah.
It's all part of the...
Well, and part of the change that's come about, and how how you got up here from wherever you lived. I lived in Elkhart, and it took hours to get up here when we were first coming up.
Yeah, when and, what, yeah. What type of car and, would you drive?
Yeah.
Those were only two lane.
And now I can get down there in 2.5 hours. You know, we kept wondering, wonder where we're going to eat, because you always had to eat on the way. Where are we going to eat?
Yeah, you know, well, I can remember, you know, when I was growing up, we used to travel from St. Louis to Michigan City, I think, and we'd spend the night there.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
And that was another 5 hours up here.
That's right. That's right.
That was in the 50s, you know. And, did you ever have any sections of dirt roads?
No,
right,
no, no, it was all paved by then.
The
well, maybe, no, I would say it was all paved by then, you know, by the time I was coming up.
Do you remember what type of cars your dad drove?
Well, they had, they always had Buicks, and he always had a business coupe. And mother had one car she had monkey seats in it, even, because there were four kids of us anyway, and the two of them. And if mother went over to school to pick up somebody on a rainy day, she was going to bring the whole neighborhood back with her, you know. So I do remember that one. That was a 29 Buick that was, oh, it was lovely.
Was it a four-door?
Oh, yeah. Oh, sure, and it had monkey seats. You know what monkey seats are? Well, they folded up into the back of the front seat. So you had the regular front seat, and you had a regular back seat, but you had enough room in here that if you had two more people, you just unfolded these little seats, and then you had room for two more people.
That's great.
Well, it was probably the predecessor of people getting a station wagon or something.
Yeah. Was it a crank start or?
No, I don't remember any. I don't remember mother or daddy having a crank start. See, the cranks. Yeah, crank starts. I'm sure must have gone off by the time. Yeah. I'd remember a car.
Do you ever remember any airplane? Did anybody fly around here in the 30s? Did you ever go up in an airplane here, or did you ever?
No.
Were there Barnstormers that would come to Whitehall or anything that you ever went to
there
see?
There probably were, but I didn't know about them. If they did, I didn't. We
didn't say you were mainly down in Sylvan Beach,
yeah.
And that was. What else do you need?
Well, actually, it was years and years before we realized there was anything north of Montague, you know. I mean, you went out on a farm up there to get eggs or something, but what you did when you went into town, that was all. You didn't go joyriding around a lot or anything.
Yeah.
One thing that was interesting that Mother used to tell about was Mr. Jackson, a farmer, lived up Pearson Creek, the old channel, way up there someplace. And in order for them to have milk, he would put the milk pails in his rowboat and a yoke that he could fit on his shoulders with extension, you know, out here. And he'd row his boat from his farm and come down the old channel and across and beach it down by the boathouse and put the yoke on and put the buckets of milk on here and walk up the hill, and they'd have a ladle, and you'd get out your crock or whatever it was you were going to keep your milk in, and he'd ladle the milk into the crock.
Was it pasteurized?
No.
Wasn't
nobody thought of pet, you got raw milk.
And no one got sick from it ever?
Heavens no,
It's probably fairly safe to do.
Isn't that marvelous? Yeah, another thing, when I was a youngster, my aunt would give me a dollar to go down to the channel and holler, Mr. Fisher, and you'd holler just as loud as you could. And pretty soon he'd come rowing over with a nice display of nicely cleaned fish all ready to cook, and so then you'd pick out a dollar's worth of fish and he'd wrap them up in a newspaper and you'd bring them back and that was dinner.
And you'd stand down the channel and just yell, Mr. Fisher.
Yeah.
Mr. Fisher. That is great.
Isn't that marvelous?
And your mom would give you a dollar just to go down.
You'd get down and get the dinner. Uh-huh.
What type of fish? Were they perch?
I think they were pretty good sized fish. Of course, one fish wasn't like any other to me back then. I was maybe 10, 12 years old. Yeah, a fish was a fish.
Yeah, you wouldn't think.
But my gosh, sometimes there were like a dozen of us sitting around the table for this dollar's worth of fish, you know.
Wow. Well, that's just the type of thing I love. It's just the end of the channel, Mr. Fisher. Now, was he on the other side of the channel?
Yeah, he was on the other side. He had to row across.
Okay.
And what I miss now is hearing the fishing boats go out, that special little noise that they,
How many fishing boats were around at that time?
There were at least three, I guess. Now, there's somebody who lives over on the other side who's a relative of the Grovers. And she could be a very good source for you, but I don't know what her name is. Yes. But I do know she lives, but I'll bet somebody like Sharky Proche could tell you who it is.
Okay.
She lives, I think, in the house that was part of the life-saving station. Okay. I think, because, you know, they kind of sliced that up and...
Yeah, because that is part of that house over there.
Yeah, so. Yeah, that's right.
Did Sharky summer up here as a young person?
Sharky was, but we didn't know her.
You didn't know her?
She was over on the, and didn't come over to the yacht club. This friend that I had down in St. Pete, they didn't belong to the yacht club, so I didn't know her.
But wasn't that wondrous, that the world of Sylvan Beach and the yacht club? I loved it as a child, the most magical moments of my life.
I know it.
It's just a wonderful time. Yeah, it is. We're lucky. We're very blessed to have had this happen to us during our lives. Well, we might as well move on to the pictures now. And again, if you think of anything next winter or something you want to do, just let me know and I've got a tape.
Well, I think this is great. You're doing this so far ahead of time, so that there is time to.
Well,
you know,
this is the type of thing you can't rush.
You just gotta plod away.
And it takes. I'll undo that.
Yeah, you undo me.
There we go. And what we'll do? Well, maybe you want to leave that on while we're looking at the pictures. I'll do is take these off. Take this off, and we'll just focus in on the pictures.
Okay.
I think I'm going to be doing that. Instead of getting them all copied, I can just do this pretty well. I don't know. We'll have to see what happens. Having never really done this heavily.
I bet you're learning a lot, though.
Yeah. Oh, it's fascinating. It's absolutely fascinating. And it's funny. The sad thing is that most of the time when I'm done filming and I'm taking you... equipment apart is when everybody comes up with the most fascinating things.
Mm-hmm.
But I think they're kind of nervous on TV at first or things like that, and then they don't think.
People,
it's kind of hard. I mean, you're on stage and, you know.
Liz Ehlers was another one in that group. She was Liz Bunnell. Yeah, she was in that same crowd with us. We had an awful lot of fun. We really did. We just hated it when the summer was this little thing twirling around here.
Yeah. Okay, now this was the inside.
This was the inside of this living room in, probably about the mid-1890s, I'm guessing. But it was when the Vanaventers owned it. I like the light fixture particularly. That's a kerosene lamp. Still have some of those chairs.
So this is the mid-1890s, and this is the Vanderbilt cottage, the original.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know who took the picture?
I don't know, but Peg said that Mr. Van, her father-in-law, taken him to the insides of where he lived, their apartment in Chicago. She has lovely pictures of the interior of that. So I guess he just...
Well, that's a good idea because it's now you can see where you live. I mean, that's really, I like that idea. I like that.
Vendor.
That's Phil. And which point to Eddie Middleton again?
This is Eddie doing his famous dive off of the pilings on the pier.
Oh, wow.
But I can't recognize the backs of those heads. But I, that's Phil Van, I do know that's on. Phil Van. Mm-hmm. Wow. With the bathing cap on.
Funny man.
Yeah.
Funny man. Okay. Again, this is...
Well, this is Mr. Van Eventer.
Okay.
And my grandfather, and they have on their plus fours, and they must have been playing golf or something or the other, because they were great buddies on the golf course.
So that's called plus fours? That
those were the knickers were plus fours. Yeah. Linen.
Was that a brand name or just a name for the...
No, that was what they called the knickers, was plus fours.
Four.
Yeah. And Tattersall, granddad's were Tattersall prints, I recall. But notice the neckties. I want you to notice the neckties.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the bow tie and then one not very long. About what year was this taken?
Oh dear, I'd have trouble guessing that. Had their picture taken after they'd raised the money, having card parties and I don't know what all, to finance getting the WOB Club.
And what year was that?
Well, let me see if Mother says. Nope, but she's got the names of the ones that she knew.
Can you read me off those names?
Well, we have seated as Mrs. Bortel, that's B-O-R-T-E-L, Mrs. Griffin. And then there's an X for an unknown and a Mrs. Temple and another X. And then we have, here, I'll just take this off and put it back on later. Standing is Mrs. Stowe, Mrs. Chittenden, this is Harriet's mother right back here.
I'll be darned.
Mrs. Forbes, she's the mother of the fellow who wrote the Sylvan Beach book. And then there's an X for the next one because she didn't know. And then Mrs. Michael, M-I-C-H-E-L-E. Mrs. Linderman and Mrs. Middleton, that was my grandmother, right here. And two X's of unknowns, that would be these two, I guess. Mrs. Benton, right back here, I recognize her. And then three X's, mother didn't know these ladies.
So.
And then above up here is Mrs. Holden and Mrs. Luton, Mrs. Lockwood, I remember her very well, Mrs. Schulter, and then X, and then Mrs. Collins was right here. And then we've got five X's, so that's one, two, three, four, for that little clutch. And then Mrs. Roberts, which would have been Elmer Roberts' mother, and Mrs. Pillinger, and then three X's. And I'm betting there's some other Mrs. Pillingers in there, too, because there were seven Pillinger families here.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Okay. Now, I don't find too much in here that's going to be...
This is the old dock down at the arcade.
And one of the people in here is George Little, who was one of Sally Summers' relatives. And I don't know whether it was her father or her uncle. He got a wire in the way there.
Yeah, I've got to get to Lorna when she gets up here.
She's going to get here about the 24th.
Of...
May.
May, okay.
Mm-hmm. And I don't know how old he was then.
Okay.
Showing you this after showing you the interior, this is what my place used to look like.
Wow.
Isn't that a wow?
Frank Adams, too. That's great.
Yeah.
This is the front of your place?
Yeah. Yeah.
I can see what you're talking about, how much more land was out here.
Well, and the cottage wasn't next door.
Oh, yeah, yeah. You wouldn't know who they were on the porch.
But those are Van Eventers.
Those are Van Eventers.
Yeah, I'd have to look at it. I might know some of them, but I'd have to look at it. But they're not my... Peg Van gave me that because she thought I ought to have it. Now, this shows you the tower on the lighthouse.
Okay. Yeah, yeah.
And some of the sailing ships and stuff of that sort. This one's a good one. I'm sorry, I don't know the name of the boat, but I think we can find it. I think we can find out. And.
Oh, look at that thing. What happened to it? It just sunk?
It just sunk.
It's plain old sunk.
I don't know if it's still down there or not. But we'll find out what that, but that's a pretty good picture of that.
That
mother took, yeah.
Where did that sink, do you know?
No, I don't. I just included that. Now here is Murray Road going up here.
Okay, and that's your boathouse right at the end.
This is the boathouse.
Where the services were held.
And this is the Van Eventer.
Wow.
And here's what trees used to look like on the bank, of course. And here's the depot.
Okay, that depot was in town then.
Yeah, that was Whitehall Depot.
Okay.
And this is Murray Road. This is where the sidewalk is now. It's a wooden thing here.
Right.
And I do not know what boat that is that's up there, that's out in front there. And this must have been the Lewis House that was later a white ledge.
Oh!
Doesn't that look like maybe that's what that is?
Yeah, okay. It does. That's a rare.
Isn't that lovely?
That is.
And I think this was, well, I'm not sure. I was going to say I think this was taken in town, but I can't swear to that. Now this is golf club.
Good lie. That's all the members? Or?
Well, no, they had a fun day. They always had some sort of thing. Here's Mr. Van Eventer. Here's Granddad. I think that's Mr. Forbes. Quite a few people in here that we would, if I really worked at it. Here's a Brightwell.
Oh.
He was a caddy.
I'll be darned. I got to talk to Ward. I called him and I got to get Ward.
Okay. But that's fine. Now, this is up the old channel, and parts of that I think were still there. But look how little the trees are.
Yeah.
Oh, here they are. Here are the life-saving fellas with their practice thing. They've dumped the boat over, and I think she took more than one picture, though. I think I've got a better one of that. And here's an old gaff rig from way. This all has to be about 1907.
1907.
And this was my Addie V, but mother didn't have a very sophisticated camera. But this is my cottage too. This is, of course, they didn't even have screens back then.
That's
Granddad. Yeah.
What did you use for flies then? Fly paper? Or
I suppose. I don't know. I wasn't
around there. Yeah, wasn't around in 1907. Yeah.
No. But I'll have to find the rest of this.
Yeah, so
this is an invaluable thing. Those are all postcards. And I have one postcard, and I don't think it's in here. That's a double postcard that you know, opens up like this, and it's got a whole line up on the White Lake side, including the old WAP club.
Uh-huh.
But, of course, this isn't an old postcard, but I think you'll like this one.
Oh, wow. Now, that structure, that wood thing built on top of the channel wall?
Oh, I thought you were talking about this one with the old car in it. Oh, there's another one that follows that one up, too. Just a minute. Is it in here? No, by George, it isn't. Well, anyway. Oh, now, wait a minute. No, I don't. He took a view from Hairpin Turn, I think, is the other one. I wonder where the heck that is. But here's this and this. These all kind of go together. I think they're someplace around the same vintage.
Okay.
And of course they didn't date those postcards because they wanted to use them for years.
Yeah, good point. Okay.
Which is a shame. And here's a more recent shot of that. And I kind of like this. This is from Pigeon Hill or something.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, old channel from Pigeon Hill. And you can see how much smaller the trees are. And this is still the old wooden pier. And it doesn't say whose ship that is.
Oh, that's
and I
beautiful.
Love this. And I'm not just positive, but maybe I don't know if that's Clarence. Could that be Clarence Pitkin?
It's too small though to get the real quality of that ship.
Very interesting. Betty and I were in there was a Pontiac that Bert had, And they were renting the cottage next door. And Betty and I remember that very well.
Were they just both going around?
Yeah, Mrs. Chittenden had a great big enormous, I think it was a Cadillac, great big thing with the trunk rack on the back and everything.
Yeah. And this was Kathleen
Middleton.
Middleton
killed in the Iroquois theater fire. Yeah.
In Chicago. God.
I didn't know all these famous people, but a lot of movie stars came to White Lake because of Professor Sidoni.
Yeah, which ones? Do you remember any of the names of the? I think Barb told me that Sophie Tucker.
Sophie Tucker's one of them. Yeah.
And then Mr. Manny told me, I can't remember the name he told me.
Crawford. Joan Crawford. Oh, gee, some of them used to show up at the dances on Saturday night.
I'll be darned. Did they have regular, they have bands there, of course.
Yeah. One of the funniest things going to a dance at the yacht club was, one Saturday I was on Betty's boat and we came in, race was over, and came into the yacht club so then when we were ready to leave, Joe Sidoni said, well, I'll see you at the dance. And I said, well, no, you won't. I don't have a date, you know, this sort of thing. So he said, oh, I'll pick you up. No problem. Well, all you had to do was get there. You know, you didn't. That was no problem. He said, no, I'll pick you up. I thought, oh, that's neat. Well, he was something like 16 years older than I was or something. And so this was really quite a
racy
thing. Oh, let me tell you, this was really, and I just, oh, he was such a dear person anyway. So when he came and picked me up and we went back out in the alley, and here is this huge, great, big, long black car of the Sidonis, of Professor Sidonis, with the chauffeur in the front seat. I think it was his secretary at that time. I don't think it was Jack DeFraga, but I'm not sure. And Art was sitting in the front seat beside the driver. So Professor and Mrs. Sidoni, and of course she was all dressed to the nines, and she dyed her hair, it was not dyed, but it had a sort of a purplish rinse instead of a bluish rinse to her white hair. Uh-huh. And it was all marcelled to a fare thee well and everything. And of course he was all dressed. Well, I hadn't expected this. I thought Joe was going to pick me up, and here was the whole entourage. So we were sitting on monkey seats, which that car had then too. He and I were sitting on these monkey seats, and I thought, yeah, I bet that Professor Sidoni just wasn't going to let Joe have the car and go up and pick up somebody to take to the dance.
Oh, that's great.
Wasn't that marvelous?
That's great.
Well, I figured they'd all just get out at the yacht club and then Joe would come and pick me up.
Yeah. How old were you when that happened?
16.
16. That must have been when we drive up and
all this business.
You were going, oh my God.
Yeah, oh my goodness, what have I done here? What have I gotten into? But it was fun. I'll never forget it. I reminded him of it sometimes.
Did you stay up for the Pirates Ball?
Yeah, because school didn't start until after Labor Day.
Uh-huh. So you'd stay for that?
Sure.
Do you remember any in particular Pirates Balls? You know?
I remember seeing your granddad there a lot, of course, and he was a big feature of it.
Yeah, and Dad still wears the outfit.
I know it. But, it was just another fun evening.
Yeah.
You know, it was just a good... And they didn't have dinners before the dances then, you see. You didn't have... You just went over to dance. They always had a full band from Muskegon, and I can't remember the name, but Neil can tell you a lot of stuff I can't.
Yeah.
But it was just fun. And everybody was there. The young people and old people and everything else.
Was there a grand march and everything?
Yeah, for the Pirates Ball.
Yeah.
One of the funniest ones was Coke Radcliffe and Jimmy Butterfield. And I think Jimmy was the baby. Now, I think that's the way it was. excuse me. They had found an old baby carriage someplace. And I don't know where. It was the funniest looking thing you ever saw. And they dressed Jimmy up like a baby. And he had a baby bottle. And here are these legs sticking out over the sides of the baby carriage. And Coke is the nurse. and he's all dressed up with his white nurse, I don't know where he got the nurse's uniform, and pushing the baby buggy. And if that wasn't the funny, and I'm sure they won. I don't remember anything other than how funny that was.
Oh, God, that sounds like a scream.
It was a scream. Yeah, Jim Butterfield. And he was just as big then, his legs were just as long then as they are now. But, oh, that was so funny.
Did he have one of those baby caps on they used to wear?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, he was in the whole thing. Well, oh, there's this little baby in there, little old baby.
Big old baby there.
Yeah.
Oh, that's neat.
But people would come up with real crazy things, and they used to make pirate boots. You'd wear black shoes, and then you'd use black oilcloth and make the things come up, and then you had the little part around here that's on a pirate boot, you know, the cuff or whatever that hangs out, yeah, whatever.
Yeah.
We were forever making those out of black oilcloth.
Did you decorate the ballroom?
I don't remember that. I don't remember that there was a decoration committee for anything. You just went and danced, yeah. That was it.
Do you remember the band, any of the bands?
Yeah, I should. I think there was one called Cornell, some such a name as that from Muskegon, but you didn't pay too much of attention to who the band was.
Yeah.
But that's another Neil Manny. Just give him a bunch of these.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to go back to him.
Just get him a bunch of questions to fill in the blanks.
Blanks, that's right. That's right. I can't remember that.
Yeah.
There's so many.
Because he can do it. I know it. I know that, but you're getting a good start on it.
Oh, yeah, and that's what I want to be, is about as thorough as
yeah,
I can possibly.
That's right.
Because at minimum, you know, hope we'll keep the tapes and we'll have them forever, and that's the important thing, I think. You know,
yeah.
The film will be nice, but we'll have to cut so much out of everything that, you know, I think it's important to keep a real visual history of all these stories, and I think it's good.
Now, practically all, if not all, of the cottages had names. This one was Pinehurst, which I thought was pretty funny when I'd lost practically all the pine trees. Well, I've planted some more. But not too many years ago, Connie Lanier thought it'd be neat. They'd come across the name of theirs up in the attic, and she thought it'd be neat if people would forage around, see if they could find the old names of the old cottages.
I think that's a great idea.
Yeah. But there were some great names, like the Buckeye were the people from
Ohio,
and the Quichuary, which wasn't in the association. That's the one Jane Pelton later tore down and built the cottage of her. She was an architect. That was the Quichuary.
What did that mean?
Quichuary.
Oh, the Quichuary, that's great.
And the Hunkler's cottage was the Sansa Sea. I don't know. I'd have to really think about that. Midge had gotten up a book because she'd found pictures of an awful lot of the cottages, and then she took more recent pictures of them, and she had these two together, and you can see the names on some of those.
And
that's got to be over
Megan. She's got a lot of stuff in her cottage.
She does.
Megan, I want to get in there. You know, maybe.
I want to get in there and see the genealogy stuff, because there's something my brother wants to know, because he's really working on family genealogy. And gosh, if Midge did all that, why should he?
Duplicate.
Yeah, why should he knock himself out trying to find all the stuff she already had?
Yeah, that's true, and it's tedious work.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
A lot of
well, he's
work.
He's been doing the work side of the family and the Bartholomew side, so he'd like the Middleton and Murray, but she has.
Okay. Now is that the Bartholomew?
No. My father's mother's maiden name was Bartholomew, and I wouldn't be surprised if there was some connection. And one of Bart's boys has been working on the genealogy, and I may nail him someday and see.
Steve or Tom?
One of the kids. I don't know them.
Yeah, it'll be Steve or Tom.
Yeah.
Nice kids.
Yeah.
Nice kids.
But
Well, that's great, Peg. That's
okay.
Anything you ever think of, right?
Okay,
now,
all right.
Don't feel like you're okay. Call me and we'll do more.
Well, I'm glad, we did this.
I'm keeping a whole tape aside for you.
Yeah, okay.
And, let's see, let me destruct this.
Apparently, Granddad had gotten it someplace. I don't know where. But isn't that interesting?
Oh, God, that's neat. And Ed Middleton had this.
No, it was always here, but
oh, is it?
He had it framed.
Okay.
He had it framed, and Mother had given it to him because he had always enjoyed it. And then he, after it was framed, he just couldn't see it over at his cottage. So he said, here, this belongs here.
I'll be darned.
And so I told his son, I said, now anytime you're ready to take your daddy's picture, you it's yours, because I don't want him to feel it, you know. Really.
And you were saying that the canvas of the painting itself is the white shirts.
All the white that's in the picture, the plain white in there, well, it's really sort of cream color now, but that is that's the background of the picture. He didn't use white paint, I guess is the easier way to say it.
And we don't know who painted this either.
Well, the name's down here. His name is Van Ness, F.L. Van Ness, Chicago, 1898.